On this week's episode, I'm joined by Daniel Rodrigues. Daniel is an award-winning Portuguese photographer. He has had his work featured in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, Al Jazeera, the Daily Mail, on CNN, and the BBC. We discuss how taking one photo changed his life, and how being Portuguese has helped him gain the trust of some of the world's most secluded communities. Welcome to another episode of Portugal, The Simple Life. I'm really happy to be joined by Daniel Rodrigues, all the way from the north of Portugal. Daniel, how are you?
Hi, I'm well, and you? Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you for joining us. Just tell us where you are. It's now clear to everybody that you are a photographer, that you have all the photos around you, but tell us a little bit about yourself.
I was born in France, because my parents were in France at the time, but I came to Portugal, and I did the school here in Portugal, and around 18 years old, I started to like even more photography, because my uncle was always with the camera when I was a kid, so it was normal for me to see cameras and photos, and I did a trip in Portugal when I was a kid with my uncle, and I think was there the love for traveling and the photography and everything was born, was when I was traveling with my uncle. And when I was 20 years old, I said, no, it's really what I want to do. So I did the course, went to the photography school in Porto, and I start my career there after that. And it's have been 10 years. I worked for a newspaper in Portugal, and after that I started to traveling. I went to Africa, and I took a photo in 2012, and in 2013 I won the World Press photo. So it was like a change life, and I start to travel even more, and work for international newspapers.
Okay, that photo was the one of the kids playing kids. Football?
Yes, it was in Guinea-Bissau.
Do you mind if I share it quickly?
No problem.
On the screen, let's see if we can just share it on our screen here.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got it.
Exactly. So
there it is.
This one.
It's an amazing photo. The contrast, the dust shooting up at the right time.
No, and the funny story about all this. All this photo is, I have thousands of photos, but this one is really special because of the whole story about this photo. Because when I took these photos, I was not like there to take photos. I was only playing soccer with them, like playing football with them. I was having fun, but I'm always with the camera. So I took this photo, and I saw on the camera, I said, yes, okay, it's a good photo, but only took this photo in March, 3 of March, and only in the Christmas, the same year, editing the photo. Because in September I was not fired, but in 2012 the journalism in Portugal was very bad, so a lot of people get fired because they didn't have money for us. So I was like depressing, like very sad and everything. And at the time, my girlfriend on Christmas said, "You are here sad. You never looked to the photo of Guinea-Bissau. Take the photo, see the photo of Guinea-Bissau, editing the photos of Guinea-Bissau, and send to the World Press photo." I said, "No, I don't care. I never won. It's impossible to win. I'm unemployed. I sold all my equipment. I was like not a photographer anymore. I sold everything. But okay," she said, "okay, let's go." And okay, so editing the photo. So only in Christmas, like 10 months after took the photo, editing the photo, and I sent to the World Press photo, and I won the first prize and changed completely my life, because I was without cameras, I was without work, I was like thinking of work in a supermarket or going outside of Portugal, because in Portugal it was also terrible to have a job. And one day they called me, you won the World Press photo, and everything changed. So it's a very special photo for me.
Amazing. I want to talk more about your photography and your travel and these things, but let's just take a step back if we can, Daniel. Where are you based in Portugal? Where's your village?
Porto, near to Porto, in Póvoa do Varzim. It's near to Porto.
Póvoa do Varzim.
Póvoa do Varzim. It's like 20 minutes from Porto. The life here is more calm. You know, you don't have so much tourists. No. With the coronavirus is different, but it's near to Porto, it's near to the airport in 20 minutes if I want to go to Porto. I'm in Porto, I live on the beach, so like every day if I want to only walk on the beach, it's okay, you don't have so much people, so it's really, really simple life. I love to live here, also in Portugal, because of that, because when I'm traveling, it's always chaos, you know, always a lot of stuff, a lot of work, and sometimes it's not easy. And the best thing is when I come back to Portugal, come back to home, to have a quiet place to live, a simple life. So I think it's the best place to live is here. And if I need something or I need see more people or city in 20 minutes, I'm in Porto.
I've never been to Porto de Varzim. I've seen pictures. The beach looks amazing.
The only problem here is the wind.
The wind?
The wind, every single day.
And how about the water? How is the water?
It's freezing, but here in Portugal, in the north, it's normal. Like when I'm in Portugal, I go every day to the beach. I never go inside of the water. It's too much freezing. For me, of course. If I go with my nephews, they go to the water, and the water is good, but not for me.
What else is your village? I mean, is that where you grew up?
No, yes and no, because I'm living in my vacation, in the vacation home, family vacation home, vacation family. So every summer, since I was born, the summer was here. So I grew up here in the summer. The rest of the days of the year was near from here, also family count. Here to Port, 30 minutes from here, but here was the summer, so I grew up here in the summer.
I mean, you've mentioned it, but you could live anywhere in the world if you wanted, because of your work. Choose why do you choose to stay?
First, because it's my country. I'm Portuguese, and I'm proud to be a Portuguese, it's cheaper. If you compare to London, New York, or like a very big city, it's cheaper here. And the food is for me is very important. Every time I go to travel, when I come back, I need to have my bacalhau com batatas, or my francesinha. I don't know if the people know.
We spoke about Francesinha in a couple of episodes ago with a gentleman called Sergio Figueira, and he's from Porto. And we spoke about Francesinha,
So it's one of the best food in the world, so you don't have Francesinha in the rest of the world. But it's also because Portugal is like amazing. I think it's quiet and... It's every time people ask me about Portugal, it's what I say. It's tiny, but you have everything. And everything is different. The people are different in the north than in the south. The food, every region is different. The landscape is different. Safety, like when an example, when I go to Brazil, when I say in Brazil, I go outside with my camera or my phone, or I drive my car with the windows open, they say, no, it's not possible. Are you sure? It's safe? Yeah, you can go outside at midnight, in the middle of the night with the camera, with the phone. You don't have a problem. It's really safe. And I like to have this kind of life when I'm not traveling, you know, and also the family, my friends. But all these things, they are very important for me, and it's the best place to live. Of course, the only thing I don't like is the water is too freezing. But we cannot have everything. But Portugal is good because of that.
Daniel, you mentioned that you were born in Paris. You came over to Portugal as a 10-year-old boy. Mm-hmm. What were your memories of that change coming from France to Portugal?
It was not a big change, only school. Why? Because at the time in France, we kids had a lot of vacation, like Carnival, Easter, summer, Christmas. So like every time I was in vacation, 1 week, 2 weeks, I was always in Portugal, you know. So since I was born, every single vacation was here, like in Carnival, like 2 weeks I was here, in the summer 3 months I was here. So it was not like a big change, you know, because my grandmother was here, my family was here, I had friends here. The only big difference was at school, and really I don't see me living in France, for example. I don't see me living in France. I'm proud to be Portuguese, and I'm a typical Portuguese, and I like that. So was not a big problem for me.
It's the second time now that you've mentioned that you're proud to be Portuguese. Yeah. Tell me what makes you proud to be Portuguese?
We are I know some regions of Portugal, they are different, but here in North we are really, really friendly, you know, like we love to talk with people, we love to receive people, and I love that, you know, like the sympathy, the good vibe, the smile, you know, and I'm really proud of that, and we are really friendly, and I think this is one of the most quality we have. We are not perfect. Of course, we are not perfect, but no one is perfect.
Nobody.
And I like that because it was boring. I don't know. It's like the way we think, the way we live, I like, and I'm proud of that.
Wonderful. I'm a new citizen, so I became a citizen last year of Portugal,
great.
And so I'm also proud to be Portuguese. it's a wonderful place.
It's one thing I like it. You have a lot of people they come to Portugal in vacation and they fell in love and they come back to live. So if the country was not good and the people was not good, this was not happening, you know. I'm proud of that also, to know that the people come to Portugal and they fell in love with the country, with the people, with the food, with the landscape, everything. I remember I was doing a work for the New York Times in Porto, and I was there working, and I saw a couple of American couple, and they asked me what I was doing, because I was doing 360 videos, so it's like a camera, a different tiny camera who shoot 360s, and they were like looking, what is this? And I was explaining, it was for the New York Times, and they said, we are from New York. Oh, great. Are you enjoying Portugal? And they told me the first thing, the first plan of the trip was 1 week in Lisbon. They arrived in Lisbon and people said, you need to go to Porto, you need to go to Porto, it's amazing. They went to Porto, was the 3 months, they were 3 months in Porto. Was the last days, the last day of their vacation. But the first thing was only 1 week in Lisbon. and they went to Porto and they stayed there 3 months. You see, so no one stayed 3 months if the city is not good and the people are not good, if the country is not good, true. I think.
Or if the food is not good.
And the food, also the food, yes.
Yeah, the food. So, well, that takes me perfectly on to our next thing. You take photos for the New York Times. You've been all over the world. Tell us a bit about that journey, how you started doing that, and some of your awards as well.
How to start? Was in 2014. They have a portfolio. The New York Times have a portfolio review every year, so you can send like a portfolio of photos. Okay. And it's like, I think it's 5,000 of people sending the portfolio. And this shoots 100 people to go to New York to present the portfolio. And I went to New York, presented the portfolio to some editors. They like it, and I start to work for them.
Okay, so hold on. Let me just break that down. So 5,000 people send the portfolio.
It's 5,000, I think. I'm not sure, but I think it's
they like, narrow it down and they invite 100 from all over the world.
Yes.
To come and present it, and then they choose, they give somebody a work.
Yes. They don't give you a work, they give you assignments. So like when there, they like the work, and they say, okay, if we need something, if some story is coming, we call you. I went to Portugal after 1 month, no, maybe 2 weeks, they give me a work in Portugal. And after that in Turkey, after that in Poland, Ukraine, Africa, everywhere.
Okay, wow. And some of your awards, Daniel, we mentioned the one with the football, but tell us some of those others.
Was one of the biggest ones, but for me it was very important because of all the story. I was unemployed without camera and everything. But one of I really enjoyed to one was the picture of the year international, because the World Press photo was only one photo, you know. So okay, it's like luck. Okay, I took these photos. It was luck. They like it. They give me the award. But the picture of the year international, they give me the third place as a photographer, the best photographer of the year in 2015. That was very good to feel, because it was not only one photo, but it was like four works, like 45 pictures. So it was not only one, it was a lot of them, and it was a lot of stories. So they enjoyed all my work, not only one photo, because one photo you can have lucky, you took that photo, okay, it's good, but the rest, it's not good.
I know you've got a couple of works there. I've seen a couple like The Hunted, a couple of the different works that you've done. Which were the ones that they graded, or which were the ones that they chose?
Was the Awaguajá, the tribe in Amazon.
Okay.
Awaguajá was the one of the horses in Galiza.
Okay.
In Brazil also, about the football in Brazil. One of about the lady boys in Thailand, in Bangkok.
Yes.
I don't remember. And more photos, I don't remember. And after that, in 2017, I was in the same contest, but only with Latinos from South America and Spain and Portugal. They give me the first prize as the best photographer of the year.
Wow.
That body of work was the albinos, the Aaron Train, another in Africa, in Mozambique, about the Grand Hotel.
Yes.
I don't remember the rest. It's a lot of photos.
The work is beautiful. I mean, your black and white images are just... stunning. You've got one of the bridge in Porto with the mist coming over the bridge. That is just is one of my favorite photos.
I was with a friend this week, and I was talking about this photo. Was without sleeping that night, because I went to I was doing a work for the tourism of Porto, and also for me about the project I have in Portugal. That these photos, they are here. I was, it's called Pinheiro. It's in Guimarães, and it's like 500,000 of people playing drums. So okay. It's like crazy, you know, like crazy, a lot of noise. I left Guimarães around 5 o'clock in the morning. It was all night taking photos. And when I arrived to Porto, I saw the fog and I said no. Because that photo, you know, sometimes you try to imagine a photo and you realize a photo in your head. And every year, every month, you try to get that photo and you cannot take that photo because it's not about you, it's about the weather. You need to have a luck with the weather. And that night was almost day. When I arrived to Porto, I saw that fog. I said, no, it's today. It's today. I don't go to sleep. I know I need to sleep, but forget. It's today. And I went to Serra do Pilar. And when I arrived there, it was that fog and with the bridge and everything. It was like the perfect shot I always imagined in my head was like in front of me. So was
right. Good. So it was a good timing and in the right place at the right time. Yeah.
Yes. You know, because I'm a lazy person. I'm really a lazy person. But as a photographer, we cannot be lazy. So it's difficult to handle that. I'm happy to that night. I was not like lazy. Like I need to sleep. I'm tired. No. I need to take that photo, and I went and took that photo, and it was amazing.
I mean, one of the things that I've read about photography a lot of the time is there's a combination of luck, but a combination of being able to see the shot before you take it. Another thing that I've read and spoken to other photographers about is you have to be able to win trust of people to be able to take photos of them and to be in that space and to be in their space. And you've been to some really, really interesting places in the world and among some really interesting groups of people. And they've allowed you to be there within them. How does that work?
First of all, about the luck, you need to be lucky, of course. Mm. But you do your luck. Mm-hmm. Like the photo of Porto. I was lucky when I arrived there, was that fog there. But I went there. If I went to home, I was not taking that photo. So I made my luck. So I think the luck it's a true thing, of course. But you need to make your luck.
Yes. Yes.
If you stay at home, you don't do anything. You don't take photos. Like the photo of the World Press photo. If I didn't went to Africa, I was lucky to take that photo. Of course, I'm the first one to say that. But I did my luck. I spent months and months saving money. Don't go to with friends, have dinners, parties, and everything. I was saving money, and with that money, I went to Africa and I took that photo, that photo and other photos. But I did my luck. So I was lucky, but I did something to arrive to that luck. So okay, sometimes you need to be lucky. But you need to do something to have that luck. And about the approaching and the that thing about my story is, I think I really like. I only photograph, take photos only, not depend of the work. But 98% of my photos are with the 35 millimeter lens. So okay. I need to be really, really, really close to the subject because. If you can see on my photos, I'm always really near with the people. And that you need to talk. I really like to talk. Like sometimes when I do a story about someone, I know I will be like 3 weeks with that people, with that people, with that person. So like the first 2-3 days, I don't take photos. Only stay there, talk to them, try to know about our life. I tell a lot of my life because it's very important. Okay, you are there to take photos of them and to know about their life, but it's very important if they also know you. So I arrive there, I talk about me, I talk about them, and sometimes it's three days without taking photos, only talking with them. And it's like you are making a friend, and after that you are friends, and it's really easy sometimes it's not easy, but it's easier if you have this connection, you know, and it's not like, it's a photographer, he came here only to take photos and it go away. No, you build a relationship with the people, and it's easier after that to take photos and to approach the people and make the photos I do.
You've obviously won a lot of trust with people, and I can see you're a nice guy. Do you think being Portuguese helps you in these situations at all?
Of course. Because the Portuguese, we have a lot of qualities, and also not qualities, but one of the qualities I like in being Portuguese and Portugal, like I said, we are really, really friendly. And we love to talk and joke and everything. And when you arrive to a person and you joke, you talk, you tell you about your story, about your life, and you listening about our life, and you talk about Ronaldo, for example. It's always good, but. To be like that, I think it's really important for my work, and it's really helpful to be Portuguese to help in my work, of course. My personality, to be like that and was raised and like a Portuguese, helps me a lot in my work. I don't know, it's the way we are, I think, and it's very important because, like the French people, I think they are sometimes really cold, you know. The personality sometimes of the French people are very cold, and when you arrive to a place and you are really cold and you don't talk, or you are like this, like looking, and you don't build this relationship like a friend, smiling, talking, if you don't do that, of course the people of the other side, the people who you are taking photos, they don't. They will be not comfortable with you, and so I think that the Portuguese ways is good, and we always figure out how to resolve something, and I think it's the best quality of the Portuguese. It's not possible to do that. No, it's possible. You cannot go to the left. Okay, but I go to the right. I go after to the left, to the right, to the left, to the right. I will be there. Okay, I cannot maybe not go directly, but I will go around, yes, and I will go there. And I think the Portuguese, it's very good in that, to find a way to resolve everything and to do the job done. Sometimes we are lazy, of course, and I'm sure you always have been an inexperienced, and you say, this Portuguese is... Sometimes it's
no,
like...
No, actually, never.
Never? In work?
No. I'll tell you, I think they are very... I think Portuguese people are very relaxed. They are very humble, but lazy, never. I've never thought that I think Portuguese are very hard workers.
No, we are. No, but when I say lazy, it's not like, you know, like, I need to be there like 11. But now I'm in bed. Okay, I will arrive like 12. Okay.
Time management is a different thing.
But sometimes we are late because we are lazy at home. You know, like let's go. Let's stay here a little bit, chill a little bit, and then we all arrive there. You know,
you can't do that with photography, because if you wait too long, you miss the opportunity.
Yes,
maybe.
Yes. But like I said, I'm lazy, but in the photo, in my work, I cannot be lazy, and sometimes it's really hard to handle that. Like, I really like to sleep, and for me, the worst thing in my work is to wake up early to take photos, because it's very hard to me to wake up like 5 a.m. in the morning to take a photo. But I do that because I need to do it, but it's not easy for me.
Daniel, when you go to all of these places, and you speak to these people from all over the world, what is their perception of Portugal? What do they think about Portugal and Portuguese people?
Ronaldo. It's Ronaldo. Only in India it's not Ronaldo, because in India they like cricket and not football.
Yeah, cricket.
But the first, when you arrive to a place and the first thing you say, you are Portuguese. Portuguese? What is Portugal? Ronaldo, Ronaldo, yay, Ronaldo! And I do a joke in there, in this place. I say I'm the brother of Ronaldo. Ah, you are not. Yes, I'm the brother. Look at me. It's the same. Look. And I start to joke about that. And give me money. Ah, no, but I'm the poor brother of Ronaldo. He don't give me money, so I don't have money for you. But I start to joke with them about Ronaldo. And after that, it's really easy to talk and everything. But I use that phrase that I use Ronaldo to help me to build a relationship. most of the people, when you talk about Portugal, they don't know Portugal. Depends of the place, but you have a lot of places. Portugal is not like kind of famous. Maybe the last few years, because of the tourism, it's on the map. But before that, most of the people didn't know where is Portugal. They think Portugal, you have some people, they think Portugal is Spain. Like it's a state of Spain, you know.
No, unfortunately, we're much better than Spain.
The last few years, it changed a little bit. With the best, like Porto won the best destination of Europe, the travel awards that Portugal won this last few years.
Eurovision.
Eurovision, everything. The soccer, Ronaldo, the soccer is important. I think they put Portugal in the map, but like in 5 years ago or maybe 10 years ago, Portugal, what is this, Spain? They didn't know. So
amazing. When I leave Portugal and I go to travel for work, and I don't go to any of these places that you've been, I go to, you know, the Netherlands or to the UK, but I miss so many things about Portugal when I'm gone. Even if I'm gone for 5 days, I miss home.
The weather.
the weather, but all the, you know, little things like, you know, here, if you walk into a cafe, people say good morning. And if you walk past someone in the street, you say good morning. In a place like London, if you say good morning to a guy on the tube, on the London Underground, he thinks that you're a crazy person. You know, he won't, and sure. So it's little things that you miss. But you go to some really, really difficult places where you see difficult things and poverty and real problems in the world. What do you miss or what do you appreciate about Portugal when you are in those situations?
You know, here you have a quality of life that's like... most of my friends say, I don't have an iPhone, I don't have a good house, I don't have a good car, I don't have like a good computer, I don't have a good life. And you have, here in Portugal, we have the best life we can have. Okay, my house is not big, but it's a house. Sometimes people, like in Africa, Asia, or even in Brazil, they don't have a house, or they have like a tiny, tiny house, like in favela, the slum, and you have 20 people living there. And here you have, okay, it's a tiny house, but it's your house. You live there, you have your stuff. And here you can travel a lot in Portugal, and you are safe. And I think this is the very important, because people, the Portuguese, don't realize how safer he is to be in Portugal. Because like you go to São Paulo, you go to Brazil sometimes, you cannot have, you, like I love to drive with my windows open. In Brazil, you cannot do that. Try to, and I say every time to my friends, try to imagine to go like near to the beach, in the road near to the beach, listening music with the open, with the windows open. Do you like it? Yes. No, try to imagine with the open close and always like looking around, like if you are safe. Do you think you can live like that? No. And in Portugal, you can live like that. And like you said, the tiny things like good morning, like you arrive to a country sometimes, good morning. Okay, good morning. And here it's like, good morning, how are you? How was your night? Are you good? Are you going to work? Like people ask you about you, ask things about you. And Portugal, you have everything. You have everything. And like I said, the safety and the poverty. We don't have poverty. Okay, you have. You have people. They are poor in Portugal, of course. But if you compare to Africa or some people from the favela or in Asia, we are really lucky to have a country like that, and you can live the way you live, I think.
Yeah, it's true. We are very lucky here.
Yeah, yeah.
Very lucky.
But people don't realize. realize that.
It's true. Daniel, you've taken photos professionally all over the world. Where in Portugal would you like to do a set of professional photos or a series? Is there a particular place?
Everywhere. Okay. Well, because you travel everywhere in the world, but your country, you don't take photos there. And sometimes you think, why I don't take photos in Portugal? It's my country, it's my people. Why I don't take photos here? And now I have this wish to take photos in Portugal, and I want to take photos everywhere of the people. Of now it's complicated because of the coronavirus, but like these tiny parties, summer parties we have in the small village in the middle of nowhere. The fishermen's, I don't know, everywhere. We have so much history in Portugal, so much culture, so much different kind of things in each region. Then I want to do a story about Portugal, about the people, about the food, about the landscape, about everything. So I want to take photos in Portugal everywhere, and not only Portugal continental, the islands also, Azores and Madeira. I was lucky. I already went everywhere in Portugal. And Azores, one of the places when I went there, I did the nine islands. And the first time I arrived there, I said, how is possible? This is Portugal. And no one, if for me, the most ridiculous things is even in Azores, if you talk to a person in Azores, like from São Miguel, they never have been in the nine islands. How is possible? I want to take photos in everywhere in Portugal to show that, not to show to the people from outside, but to show to the Portuguese, like, you have this. This is your culture. This is your country. Try to enjoy. So I want to take it everywhere.
Well, I love the photo. I mean, I love all your photos, but my favorite are the ones that I follow your Instagram, and my favorite are the ones that you take of Portugal. You've got some beautiful black and whites of Porto. You took
Porto is a project I'm doing. Mm-hmm. Many years ago. It's with a different kind of, like, I work with Fuji now. Mm-hmm. 6 years, I changed to Fuji 6 years ago, maybe. But the photo of Porto they are taking with a Leica. It's a monochrome, was the first camera they gave me at the time, because most of the people, they don't know, but they think Leica cameras are made in Germany, but not, are made in my hometown. The factory of Leica is in my hometown, and all the aim, this kind of cameras, the Leica, are made in Portugal. And at the time, they gave me the first camera in the world to take photos digitally in black and white. So they gave me that camera, and all the photos of Porto, they are taking with that camera. So I don't have that photos in colors. I didn't take the photo in colors and change to black and white. No, it's only black and white because of the camera only take photos in black and white.
Wow.
So the project I have of Porto, it's only with that camera with a 50 millimeter lens, and I'm doing like everywhere. Sometimes I'm here in Portugal, like when there was the lockdown in March, like with Porto empty, I took the camera and I went to Porto to take the photos with that camera for my project of Porto.
They are beautiful. I love them. So I look forward to more photos of Portugal as well. Daniel, how can people find you online, and how can they follow your work?
I'm most of all active on Instagram. So my Instagram is Dani Rodrigues Photo. I have also Facebook. It's also Dani Rodrigues Photo. And on my website, danielrodriguesphoto.com. But the most important, the platform I use the most is on Instagram. So you can follow on Instagram. You can send messages, I respond and everything. I'm very happy to respond to the people. And you can see my work and follow my work there.
Wonderful. We'll put links in the show notes for people to follow and to find your work. I know that they can also order, people can also order copies of your prints, right, of your photos.
Print. Yes. If they want, people want prints, they need to send me an email with the photo and send the price. Now this week, three prints go to America. One of is the WordPress photo, and one of the thing I like to print, it's completely different to see the photo printed that on the computer. Like you can see, I print everything, every single photo I take, I put in this print. But when you see like the photo of the WordPress photo, like very large on the wall, like in my living room, it's another thing. And I'm very happy to know that people want to have my photos in the living room and in the whatever, in the our house, and have a frame of my photo there. So I'm really happy when the people want that. So if people want, only send me an email and we can talk. Good.
Daniel, three things that people can remember and take away from this conversation.
Portugal is amazing. Let me see. It was a good conversation. So it's not easy to put everything in three words. But Portugal is amazing. It's simple. Proud of the Portugal photography. It's the stories about photography, the people you can meet. I think we talked about that. It's I would like people remember that. And we are lucky to live in this world that some people they don't have this opportunity.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Daniel, a question that we ask all of our guests: Portugal, the simple life, why?
Why? We are like that. We are, it's the way we are, and I didn't change anything in that. So I think the simple life is not only because of the food of the country, but because of the people. Because it's the people who make Portugal simple. So I think it's why, it's because of the people.
I agree. Thank you so much. I've loved this conversation. It's been fascinating. I look forward to following more of your work and seeing your photos. And for now, Daniel, I'm going to let you call it.
That's a wrap.
So thank you once again to Daniel, and thank you to all of you. Please subscribe, share with your friends, give us a thumbs up, and please leave a comment or a review. We'd love to hear from you. And as we say in Portugal, Força. Welcome to the simple life.